are we celebrating? U.S. carbon, we're celebrating spring, first day of the spring, spring equinox today. So that's, yeah, you can start it around. We're celebrating U.S. carbon emissions, lower than they've been in 15, 18 years, back to 1995 levels. Perhaps U.S. carbon emissions have peaked and will never hit the heights they were in 2005. Here's the thing I think you guys will love. Last year, the U.S. installed more solar photovoltaics in 12 months than we have in the 60 years since the technology was invented at Bell Labs. We installed more in 1 year than we had in 60 years. Now, don't let that go to your head, because the Germans also installed more last year than the Americans have in 60 years. And so did the Italians. And the Germans, I never really aspire to keep up with the Germans, but when the Italians are installing more in 1 year than we've done in 60 years, it reminds me we still have a ways to go. But I would like to celebrate doing a lot of solar photovoltaics last year, probably about $12, $15 billion of solar went into the ground last year, and $25 billion worth of wind energy was installed last year. I'm not going to talk about fracking, because I think in some ways fracking is the least interesting part of what's happened with shales. Not uninteresting or unimportant, but I think other things are more intriguing to me about what has happened in the last 10 years. And so let's talk a little bit about them. There's been an unbelievable amount of hype recently about America striding towards energy independence and all of the above, and that we are going to be the Saudi America of the world, and that OPEC is doomed, and that North America will soon be producing all of its own oil and natural gas. And there's a kernel of truth in that, surrounded by an enormous amount of hype and exaggeration and fantasy. This is a talk that I first did in Aspen some time ago, so a portion of it is kind of geographically set in Garfield County over in on the western slope. But here's the story, and we've lived through this story and we all understand it to one degree or another. In the last 12 years, 100,000 oil and gas wells have been drilled in the Rockies, half of them in just five counties. And Weld County would be on that list, Garfield County, San Juan County in New Mexico. But the rest of the story is really intriguing. The technology initially developed to unlock Colorado's tight sandstones has sparked a global energy revolution. Oil and gas extraction is now the dominant land use in North America, and may be so for a century to come. It's a story of human ingenuity and advanced technology meeting ancient geology. Technology has its own drive, its own acceleration. It's almost independent of human desires now, it seems to me. If you think even of computers or smartphones, technology is just, it's a thing unto itself, and it has desires and appetites, I think, that are even separate from perhaps our own. This new technology that we've been developing, which is primarily but not entirely horizontal drilling, hydraulic fracturing, 3D seismic surveys, and a lot of computer wizardry that is just, I mean, the oil and gas industry is the most computer intense industry on the planet. They hire the smartest people on the planet, and the new technology that these people have invented has been extremely disruptive, not only to the land and the earth, and I'll just say a little bit about that because you're familiar with it, but also disruptive to conventional wisdom, 10 years ago, everybody in the country, all the energy experts knew that we would be importing each day now five tankers, not full of crude oil. We would need those tankers full of crude oil, but we would also need five tankers every day full of liquefied natural gas. That was just understood. And there were dozens of applications to build liquefied natural gas terminals, and it turns out we have not needed any of them. It's been disruptive to the coal industry. When people speak of a war on coal, it's not a war being waged by President Obama, it's a war being waged by cheap natural gas prices. It's been incredibly disruptive to the revival. The nuclear renaissance died before it was born because of cheap natural gas caused by this glut of shale gas that's come on in the last 10 years. It's been disruptive here in Colorado. Shale gas has killed drilling on the western slope, and it's slowed drilling in the Powder River Basin and on the Pine Deal Anticline in Wyoming. We're now exporting coal to Europe because coal that we were previously burning is now going unburnt in this country as utilities switch coal plants, retire old coal plants, which is a good thing in terms of carbon, and push more natural gas through existing gas plants. The new technology is saving you, perhaps on a family basis, $300 or $400 or $500 a year directly on your heating and power bills. This is a map that's commonly shown to show both the tight gas and most of the shale plays in North America. And I was stunned when I first looked at this and I started thinking, man, that is a big chunk of the lower 48 turned over to one industry. And then we did a study with NRDC, and they found, with only having an intern work on it for about a month, that at least 7%, and I think it's higher than that, I think the oil and gas industry now owns or has leased 10% of the lower 48. The oil and gas industry controls more acreage than we will plant in corn and wheat. The oil and gas industry has every intention, basically, of harpooning much of the lower 48 in the decades to come. Now, the other thing that's intriguing to me about looking at this map is thinking about everything that's kind of here in the Rockies, sort of drawing a vertical line from New Mexico up into Canada. And I was curious about the explanation of that, and I started reading some geology and talking to geologists. And this takes you back, then you start going back, and you go back millions and millions, tens of millions, hundreds of millions of years. But this is what North America looked like about 100 million years ago. Before there were mountains here, there was, here on our Mile High Prairie, was the floor of an ancient sea. And this sea has many different names. It's called the Great Interior Seaway or the Cretaceous Seaway, or the Sundance Sea. Some people call it the Mancos Sea. Some people call it the Niobraran Sea. And the Niobrara is the layer in these sediments deposited by this sea that are being drilled so vigorously here just to the northeast of us in Weld County, the DJ Basin, the Wattenberg Field. This thing at its maximum cut the continent in half. It was 2,000 miles long, was 600 miles wide, and it endured for tens of millions of years. It's interesting to try to cast yourself back into this time. The dinosaurs were around. This is a picture, an artist's exaggeration of a dinosaur having the bad luck to fall in to this sea and encounter a number of these large plesiosaurs and mosasaurs that were sort of shark-like reptiles that had to come to the surface and breathe, but were also vicious predators in that time period. At this point in Earth's history, the North Pole was as warm as Denver is today. As best we can tell, there was 3 to 10 times more carbon in the atmosphere. The parts per million may have been, right now they're around 400, may have been as high as 3,000, even 4,000. Some people speculate. Very warm. The seas were very productive. And you find fossils like this in Kansas today. If you drive to Utah, you also see remnants of this ancient landscape that is pivotal now to our modern energy system. You see remnants everywhere in Utah. This is a place called Factory Butte out by Capitol Reef National Park. And you're seeing the top of this is a formation, the very bottom of the Mesa Verde formation, but everything below, all the gray slopes there that erode and typically don't have much vegetation, that's the Mancos formation. And again, in the Mancos formation is a layer of limestone and chalk and sandstones, a thin layer that's the Niobrara. Now you can't fracture the Mancos because the shales, the clays are too plastic, they're too ductile. But the Niobrara, the limestone and the chalks are brittle, which means they are can be fracked and you can get economic wells drilled into them. Now this Mancos layer was 5,000 feet thick by the time all was said and done. And on top of it was 3,000 feet of Mesa Verde formation and then some other additional layers. Total depth in many of the basins here in the Rocky Mountain West are 10,000 feet, 12,000 feet, 15,000 feet in some places. And that's why you have oil and gas development in many, if not most, of the basins in the Rocky Mountain West. So this is what's prompted Halliburton now to effectively be fishing in the Mancos Sea. Next time you're in Palisade, leaving Grand Junction, driving east, look at the mountain next to you. It's called Mount Garfield. There's a wonderful hike up Mount Garfield, and you can walk through an entire petroleum system in about 90 minutes. Historically, if we go back 40 years, two-thirds of the natural gas being produced in the United States was produced in three states, Texas, Louisiana, and Oklahoma, as well as the shallow waters of the Gulf of Mexico, and that's what you're seeing here. But around 1980, people in the gas industry got spooked. Things were happening. We were drilling like crazy in 1982 because it was just after the second oil crisis in the late 70s, and we were looking for oil, not finding very much. We drilled 80,000 wells each year in the early 80s. Never before have, and never since have we drilled anywhere near that number. But the conventional natural gas, the easy natural gas, was going downhill despite all this drilling. And the search was on, it's sort of a national search, was on for what became known as unconventional natural gas. Was there additional methane trapped in other sorts of rock formations? And the answer turned out to be yes, but it was not clear that the answer would be yes initially. The focus in the early 80s was on two different types of unconventional gas, coal bed methane, which the largest coal bed methane field in the world is in the San Juan Basin in northwestern New Mexico, and also on tight sandstones, sandstones whose density feels much like concrete, but whose permeability is even less than concrete. And this Mesa Verde formation, again, is 3,000 foot thick in many places. It stretches all the way from Farmington, New Mexico, all the way up to Pinedale, Wyoming. And I find this so ironic that the Anasazi were finding shelter inside a petroleum system, inside a reservoir rock, and had no idea, happily running their civilization on incoming solar energy for many centuries, even as they were dwelling inside gas fields, essentially. Now, the trouble with these sandstones is they were tight. They were, one explorer said they were tighter than tombstones. And there were many attempts initially. This is a photograph taken in the late 40s in Kansas. The initial fracking took place in Kansas. They were taking Air Force plane engines and mounting them on the back of a dual axle truck like this and fracking shallow gas wells. But a little internal combustion engine like this was no match for the Mesa Verde formation. So the Atomic Energy Commission in the late 70s decided that there was a better solution for fracking these sandstorms. And they called it Project Plowshare. And in two different locations in Colorado, they exploded nuclear weapons underground to fracture these tight Mesa Verde sandstorms, only to discover that the natural gas was radioactive and that there was no market for it, which is, you know, kind of a duh moment, but not the first for the DOE. As it turned out, coal bed methane, tight gas, and shale gas have ridden to the rescue. You can see that this conventional gas has continued its decline even to today. We had lunch yesterday with a guy named Richard Nehring, who has the best database of oil and gas fields in America. He said the largest conventional gas fields we're finding each year now, the largest ones, are not big enough to meet the nation's gas appetite for more than 8 hours. So you would need 40 of these fields to meet 2 weeks worth of gas demand in the US. So even as shale gas has come in and plugged this hole, this conventional gas continues to decline. Essentially, we've used it. And most of the unconventionals, 90% of them, could not be drilled, could not be produced unless they're fracked. Essentially, we've tied the future, the energy future of this industrial civilization to hydraulic fracturing, whether you like it or not. Briefly on coal bed methane, the San Juan Basin was the biggest area, but around 12 years ago, there became this drilling frenzy in the Powder River Basin up in Wyoming. And drilling is a very testosterone-driven business. Most of the people in the business are male, and I find it very interesting that the defenders, the heroic people doing the on-the-ground work to kind of protect the landscape, many of them are women. Many of my heroes are actually heroines, women that have dedicated their lives. And this woman, Jill Morrison, here with the white hat on, lives up in Sheridan, Wyoming. And she's quite interesting to visit with about coal bed methane in the Powder River Basin. In the space of 5 years, they drilled 25,000 wells up there. Because they were very shallow, you could drill them with a water drilling rig. And Jill's thing is, man, those guys eviscerated our landscape. It could have been done right, but the profits were too slim, and industry basically came in. A lot of small operators came in with sort of a rape, ruin, and run kind of mentality. And when you fly over parts of northeastern Wyoming now, you're just kind of gut struck by what's happened to the landscape. To get coal bed methane out of these coal seams, you first have to dewater the coal seams. So you're taking this water out and dumping it on the ground. Some of it is too saline and will actually poison irrigated fields. Then you have to build your roads in and drill these wells very close together. And this is just kind of a disemboweled landscape now. It's been shattered, it's been disruptive. And these scars are a pretty arid part of the world. These scars will be there for a long time to come. I was curious, who was the Steve Jobs of fracking? We had this kind of primitive fracking, but who were the people that unlocked these tight sandstones? And there are a number of really intriguing characters. These two guys here, Neil McMurray on the left and a geologist, Ed Warner, here on the right, they unlocked the Jonah Field up north of Rock Springs and somewhat south of Pinedale. And the Jonah Field looks like, I'll show you a picture of it in a moment, but Neil McMurray, he was a paving contractor, he hated unions, he drove a Cadillac when he wasn't in a pickup truck like this. He was a classic kind of Wyoming guy. And he found this brash biologist, Ed Warner, who was Brooklyn born. And Neil's whole thing was press on, get up early and stay late. And Ed's thing was no guts, no glory. And in the late 80s, they assembled a big tract of land where the Jonah field is today. People knew there were oil and gas there since the 1950s, but nobody had been able to drill economic wells in that part of the world. And these guys figured it out. They did enormous fracs and discovered what has turned out to be the biggest mineral trove. This is only 23 square miles, and it'll end up yielding about $15 billion worth of natural gas, something like that, $15, $20 billion worth of natural gas. One of the biggest mineral strikes in American history since the silver boom in the late 1880s and 90s. Now, the first thing they discovered when they're drilling these tight sandstones is there's very little conductivity between one well and the next, which meant they continued to downspace. You come in, you drill them at 80-acre spacing, then 40-acre spacing, then 20-acre spacing, 10-acre spacing. Now they're down to 5-acre spacing. In the Jonah field, they'll end up drilling something like 5,000 wells in this field, in this small area. Another candidate for the Steve Jobs of fracking is this guy. Everybody has wonderful things to say about Bill Barrett, who ran Barrett Resources based in Denver. He's still alive today. He's started another company also called Barrett Resources after his first company was bought out by larger oil and gas companies. And Barrett was the guy that figured out the Piance Basin over in western Colorado. And this is what the Piance looks like. A conventional oil and gas field looks like the kind of things on the side of this image, where you would have water underneath either a gas accumulation or water underneath an oil and gas accumulation. And these are typically found in anticlines or some sort of structural trap or stratigraphic trap that you'll find in various kinds of places, but they're typically not very big. Rangeley, Colorado would be a good example of this. But what we had in the Piance was something different. We had a continuous gas accumulation covering not tens of square miles, but hundreds, even thousands of square miles. And it took some time to understand how you got this, why was the gas there, how you might develop it, how you might frack it. And Bill Barrett and his geologists and his engineers were the ones that figured that out. And then underneath the Mesa Verde, this is the stuff in orange there, that's the Mesa Verde formation. And underneath it is the part of the deeper parts of the sediments where the natural gas is actually being produced, both in thin coal seams, some of them are not that thin, but in coal seams and in the Mancos Shale proper. This is a cross-section of what you might have over in the Piance Basin. One geologist compares. These are all little sandstone layers that were deposited by fluvial streams just meandering across the landscape for many millions of years, coming in from the western side of that big sea I showed you earlier, the Mancos Sea. There were all these, there was a mountain range out there in Utah called the Savior Range, and all these streams kind of ran out just very gently, kind of the way the Mississippi is today. And every time they made a big bend, they laid down a sandstone and a sand bench, and then eventually they became rock. One geologist compares it to throwing a bunch of potato chips in a bowl. And when you drill into these, into that bowl, this layer here where the chips are is 1,500, 2,000 feet thick, typically. You're never sure which individual sandstone you're going to encounter, you just know that you're going to hit some of them. And we began to see the same land use pattern 15 years ago in Garfield County that had been demonstrated at Jonah. Now this had the ironic, the grassroots groups went nuts about this because they were just destroying the surface, trying to get access at the underground minerals. And, but it had the ironic outcome was forcing the oil and gas industry to get really good at directional and then horizontal drilling, because this was unacceptable. People looked at this and they did some research. They said, wow, this is the densest gas field in the world. This is the densest drilling pattern you can find anywhere on planet Earth. And this will not work in the long run. You're going to have to drill more than one well from a single well pad. Therefore, you're going to need directional drillers. At that time, there were fewer directional drillers in the Rockies than there were heart surgeons. This guy's a friend of mine, Charlie Brister, and I buy him a hamburger at Denny's whenever he comes through Glenwood, and he's usually exhausted, but he's a wonderful, literate guy. He's worked in the solar industry. He's worked on nuclear power plants. He's very thoughtful and very articulate, and I'll send him emails from time to time, and I emailed him. I said, Charlie, what's it like when you guys strike oil and gas on a drilling rig? And he wrote me back. He said, the belief that hydrocarbons are the product of the life force is very common on a drilling rig. Crude smells like a perfume that evokes an ancient memory, something from our prehistoric life. He was the first directional driller that I ever met. And if you think about the challenge, I mean, Charlie's one of these guys up in North Dakota now that'll go down 9,000 feet and then take the scene that they're drilling, producing from in the Bakken Formation in North Dakota is only about 10 or 12 or 15 feet thick. And you have to get your drill bit into it and then you have to follow it for a mile. And that layer is not uniform, it's faulted, it goes up and down. So you have to be able to go back or go up or go down. He could take his drill bit in a mile underground and bring it through this window and take it out through that window. Now, you think about it, how do you know where the drill bit is? Well, they've invented all these ingenious technologies for understanding where exactly they are underground, what direction they're headed, how low they are, how high they are. It's wizardry. It's beyond technology now what these guys are doing. Gas prices soared after the hurricanes in 04 and 05. At one point in 06, gas prices hit $13, where historically they had been more likely to be $1.50 or $2. And by 2008, there was an unbelievable drilling boom in Garfield County. We had close to 80 or 90 drilling rigs there at that point, many more than there were in Saudi Arabia. Okay, so now we've unlocked coal bed methane, we've unlocked tight sandstones, and then we begin thinking about shales. There was one other Steve Jobs candidate that I didn't introduce you to, a guy named George Mitchell, and he worked down around Dallas-Fort Worth unlocking the Barnett Shale. If you fly into that airport, then you can see drilling rigs all across the horizon down there. And shales had always been of some interest to petroleum geologists, but also easily dismissed. They weren't sexy like a really nice natural gas field. A single well or two can drain a square mile. Shales, everybody understood, were the original source rocks for these hydrocarbons all over the world, but they were very impermeable. You can think about, you would say, if shales weren't so impermeable, you would say they suck. Getting natural gas out of a shale is akin to putting five layers of saran wrap over your face and then trying to breathe. So the rocks were intriguing, but they were off limits. They were kind of like the really cute guy you were never going to get a date with in high school. They had a lot of potential, but they were never going to pay off. So they were drilled in, I don't know where I'm going with that analogy, but they were drilled, but only lightly, and generally not very economically. America has always been the RD&D lab for the global petroleum industry, and in the last few years, tens of billions of dollars every year has been spent by French, Chinese, Norwegian, Indian, Japanese. People are coming from all over the world, Italians, to see what these crazy Americans are up to with their horizontal drilling, their hydraulic fracturing. Now, here's the problem with shales. This is what they call a pore throat, that opening in a shale, but it's taken with an electron microscope. So these pore throats, the gas has to flow through these pore throats, and gas can sometimes get through there, Oil has a much more, oil's a bigger molecule than natural gas. Some of these pore throats are only a little bit bigger than a single molecule of natural gas. So even though shales have some porosity, they have some openings inside them, they don't have very good connectivity. And that's where fracturing comes in. If you can't fracture these, you would never drill them. It's just out of the question you'd even begin to drill them. So here's the bottom line. Since 2008, the shale gas and tight oil production increases in these two things. When you convert it all to barrel of oil equivalents, is equal to about 4 million barrels of oil a day just in the last 5 years. That's like two Prudhoe Bays, more than two Prudhoe Bays. It's the most rapid energy increase in American history. And that's why there's been all this hype. That's why there's been all this well-deserved celebration in a sense. If you go back even a little further, if you think, where would America rank as a, on the global scale, if we just counted the oil and natural gas that we were getting from shale formations, if we just, we discounted all the conventional Prudhoe Bay, all the conventional oil fields in the United States, and we just calculated what we were producing today from wells that we've drilled since the year 2000, the U.S. would be the 14th largest oil producer on the planet, and we would be the second largest natural gas producer on the planet just from the drilling we've done into shales in the last 12 years. So these things are a phenomenon. They're a miracle. They are wholly unexpected, but the miracle has a flaw. The miracle is destined to be fleeting, particularly with respect to tight oil. The miracle, and what people aren't talking about is this flaw. They're not talking about this mirage-like nature of these wells. What do I mean? There's a rare disease that young kids get. It's called progeria. It's a disease of accelerated aging. There are only a few cases a year on the planet. And these wells, all of them, both the shale gas and tight oil wells, essentially have the same sort of disease. It's a disease of accelerated aging, accelerated depletion. And despite the triumph that the roughnecks have worked out on the land, if it's a triumph, and I think in some ways it is, there's a danger here that's not fully appreciated. Only there are actually three dangers. What would happen if oil prices went back down to $50 a barrel? You'd never drill a single tight oil well in the United States. It wouldn't be economic. So the tight oil, and I'm separating the oil and the natural gas, the tight oil we're drilling for needs $80, $90, $100 a barrel. So it's always going to be expensive. The second danger is, and only in America would someone not ask this question. The second, this is a photograph of the Bakken, a diagram of the Bakken field up in western North Dakota. They're producing 750,000 barrels a day up there right now. Each of these black dots, can you see them? Do they show up? Each one of them is a well. And the legs are the horizontal, or the things Charlie's drilling. The legs are these mile-long laterals. Now, you can ask yourself, you can see how densely drilled this place is already. And you have to ask yourself, what happens when you run out of well locations? So that's the second risk. First risk is prices drop and you stop drilling for this. The second risk is that sooner or later you run out of places to drill. And the fundamental problem is that shales have Sisyphean math. They're subject to the extreme unusual gravity that's been difficult for me to get my mind around. It's as if you launched a space shuttle and the higher up it went, the greater the downward force on it became. It's much more difficult to keep the Bakken field at 700,000 barrels a day than it would be to keep it at 50,000 barrels a day. Richard Nehring yesterday, he said it's like since 1970 when U.S. oil production peaked, the oil and gas industry has been like Sisyphus. They've been fighting back against depletion. They've been pushing a rock unsuccessfully uphill. And Nehring said it's like now Sisyphus has hit a flat spot. Sisyphus is now up on a plateau where it's easier to roll his boulder. But he's going to roll his boulder along for 5 or 10 or 15 years and then encounter another hill. And there's no more turtle, there's no more shale underneath the shale, right? The shales are like literally, in a sense, the bottom of the jar. What Texas is doing right now, producing 2 million barrels a day, they need 800 drilling rigs to do. And the New York Times is extolling what Texas is doing. And maybe it deserves to be extolled. But Kuwait can do the same thing with 35 drilling rigs. What the Saudis are doing with 50 wells, that is producing a billion barrels, will take 5,000 wells here in Colorado to also produce the same billion barrels. So drill, baby, drill is no longer optional. Drill, baby, drill is destiny. And in a way, it's manifest destiny. This is a decline curve for a typical shale gas well in the Haynesville formation. Now, the Haynesville is a remarkable place. This was a play in Louisiana that no one had heard about as recently as 2008. But in a single period of 3 years, with about 2,500 wells, the Haynesville formation was producing more natural gas than we do in Colorado. Now, we have 50,000 wells. So in 3 years, they went from a dead stop to producing more natural gas than Colorado, Wyoming, or New Mexico, three states that had been in the gas business for 50 years. But this is a decline curve for the normal Haynesville well. Now, on the bottom, these are not years, these are months. This is progeria. This is a well dying as it's born, producing exuberantly for a period of some months, but then quickly abating and becoming uneconomic. A well like this will not have a lifetime of 30 years or 20 years or 15 years. It'll have a lifetime of 7 or 8 years. Manifest Destiny was all about an arrow pointing west, you know, channeling this enthusiasm, this energy in America to the West Coast. But I argued in a recent Christian Science Monitor piece that I wrote that, you know, our compass bearing now is not west, it's down. We've essentially chained the energy future of this civilization and this country of 300 million people. We've chained it. We've chained ourselves to a drilling rig, essentially, and thrown away the key. Now, how might we think about this? I think you could think about it 100 different ways. So if you were a roughneck working on a drilling rig, you might say this, and I'll let you read this. I think this is what a roughneck would say. He might say, suck it up. Each drilling rig has to meet the needs of 150,000 Americans. If it's 30 below, we're working. If it's 95 in the shade, we're working. We're going to drill 45,000 wells this year, and most of them wouldn't be spudded unless they could be fracked. That's one perspective. Here's another one. This guy, Tim DeChristopher, many of you will have read about him. He's the guy that went into a BLM gas lease auction without a penny in his pocket, and they asked him, do you want to bid? And he said, sure, I'll bid. So they gave him a paddle, and they began auctioning these parcels near Moab, and he was outraged. I mean, these were in Red Rock wilderness areas or wilderness study areas. I met him before he was arrested, some years before he was arrested. A very intense guy came up to me after I had done a climate talk at the University of Utah and said, man, you really sugarcoated. You didn't really tell people how serious this climate challenge is. And I had to plead guilty in a way I hadn't. So he ended up bidding and winning many of these parcels with no intention of ever actually paying for them. It is a little bit outrageous how the government auctions off this land. I live in Carbondale, we've got 100,000 acres just west of town that was auctioned off for $2 an acre. Unbelievable, $2 an acre. I mean, you can't buy a latte, you know, for $2. I mean, it's stunning. And DeChristopher was angered by this. And if you ask him now about shale gas, shale oil, he said, you know, we need to stop burning all fuel, not trying to find more. The last time carbon dioxide levels were this high, sea level was 75 feet higher. We're going to drown half of Florida, not to mention the world's large coastal cities. They put him in prison, and it's interesting. There's a wonderful interview with him in Orion magazine with Terry Tempest Williams. He says, all these people are trying to get me out of jail. We need to get many more people into jail.
He's going to be released on Earth Day this year.
Is he going to be released on Earth Day? So what does the future hold? I think this is my last slide. Maybe there's one more. You know, we're going to be drilling and fracking ad infinitum, probably a million more wells in the U.S. by 2040. There are going to be tighter regulations on fracking because what you could do in Wyoming isn't going to play in Pennsylvania. We've already begun to see that here in Colorado, more pushback. Longmont and Lyons and you know, Fort Collins, a number of communities beginning to push back against fracking. Cheap gas, it won't stay as cheap as it's been because it's not economic, but it's created headwinds for coal, nuclear, and to a certain degree wind and solar, saving you money. You know, Yellowstone National Park in the northwest corner of Wyoming is a huge national park, 2 million acres. Well, these five companies have leased three Yellowstones, essentially, here in Colorado. And the 50,000 active wells we have in the state may double by 2025, just as a rough guess. There's one other person that we ought to interrogate. You know, as I've been thinking about this myself, I just kind of muse about this, and I've asked myself, what does technology want? And what does carbon want? What does all this 80 and 100 million year old carbon want? Is it kind of bored with being caught up in the Mancos Shale? Does it want to cycle again? Carbon lives for cycling. Does that carbon have any desire? These ancient plankton and little microscopic sea creatures, do they want to be back on the stage again? And what do people want? And then I ask myself, can you have Cretaceous carbon without having a Cretaceous climate? Again, this period in Earth's history was very warm, and sea levels were very high compared to where they are today, hundreds of feet higher. The North Pole was as warm as Denver. Can you mine and burn Cretaceous carbon without having a Cretaceous climate? I think that's maybe it's not an open question. Maybe we have the answer to that already. And then what does nature want? I emailed Charlie once and I said, Charlie, you know, you guys, you're drilling the Deepwater Horizon, that explosion, they had drilled into a formation that had pressure of 15,000 pounds per square inch. You have 30 PSI in your bike tires. You have 80 PSI in your household plumbing. Imagine 15,000 PSI. And I said, Charlie, what is it like drilling down into these formations where you're dealing with temperatures 300, 400, 500, 600 degrees Fahrenheit and these enormous pressures? What is it like jousting with Mother Nature? And he wrote back, he said, Randy, when we talk about Mother Nature, we're not talking about a kindly grandmother, but a moody, capricious punk rocker, someone we respect and fear. And I think we're beginning to see this person, this energy, this this woman is coming ashore. You know, we're encountering her now more frequently, I think, in our extreme weather, in droughts, in superstorms, in floods, in extreme events of all kinds. So thanks for your time tonight. I appreciate it. I can take a few questions. Somewhere here, yeah. Do you have a question?
Yeah, I do.
Does anybody have a question?
So Randy, you gave us a terrific overview, and I'm curious, what would you say about the water that's being used for all of our extraction of these oils and gases?
Yeah, so this water-energy connection is really intriguing now, and it's actually kind of a whole card that I think we're going to play with both solar and wind. It takes 3 to 5 million gallons to frack a single well. And the water constraints, particularly in West Texas now, which is a shale play that I hadn't mentioned, are very extreme. And there's a lot of pressure now on the industry to begin recycling its water, to practice water efficiency. Water and energy, buddy, you know this, but they're sort of similar. You need water to produce energy, you need energy to produce water. We wouldn't have the kind of energy system or the kind of hydrological system we have in Colorado without lots of energy pushing water around. So I in places, farmers are now selling their water rights to oil and gas companies. I think that's happening. It's probably happening here in Colorado for sure. It's a whole card for WIN, though. It's one that I've talked with Larry Flowers quite a bit about. He works for WIN now. Yeah, sure. Maybe you carry the microphone.
In the UK, and in Europe, they're apparently using technologies that are less sensitive to the environment than ours. Do you know anything about that?
In terms of fracking?
In terms of fracking.
Yes, yeah, so one of the open questions is whether this actually is going to be a global revolution. We know their shales are quite ubiquitous. The rocks are fairly common in many parts of the world. But nowhere do you have 1,500 drilling rigs. Do you have Halliburton? Do you have the kind of service company personnel that we have in the U.S.? I think there are only 6 drilling rigs in the entire country of the United Kingdom, onshore rigs. There's more stuff offshore. It's not likely that you would drill for shales offshore that much because they're just, particularly, they're probably not going to be economic flow rates. You need conventional reservoirs to justify offshore development. Will you have a big shale industry in China? People that are concerned about climate think anything that can get the Chinese to burn less coal would be a good thing. I'm not aware that the British are using worse technologies than we are here. In fact, there have been lots of talk about can you frack with propane rather than water? Can you frack with some other, you know, Governor Hickenlooper was actually claiming that he was willing to drink frack fluid. Which I can envision a frack fluid that you could drink, although a lot of it has an acid in it. You have to kill all the bacteria that are in the wellbore, so you need an acid, a biogenic agent to do that. And the more important thing about frack fluid, I was disappointed in John to do that because it seemed like a dumb stunt. You would never drink, even if the frack fluid that you put down was non-toxic. The frack fluid coming back out, the produced water, is poisonous, is a carcinogen, even if nothing you sent down. I mean, there are lots of carcinogens in planet Earth right now, so you'd never drink produced water.
So I've actually heard before that they're finding that the wells are getting depleted much faster than anticipated, as you said. I was just curious, at what point, I mean, at the same time, you still hear the references to 100 years of natural gas. I mean, people are producing those. You know, it's EIA. It's not partisan people. It's not, you know, it's professional geologists. So I wondered, you know, are you starting to see that be taken into account? Are estimates being revised to do this? And when they are revised, is it that we have 20 years of natural gas? Is it, you know, just compared to what we've heard?
So this meme that we've got 100 years worth of natural gas started at the Colorado School of Mines. They have a volunteer group there called the Potential Gas Committee. But the Potential Gas Committee is not looking at reserves, proven reserves. They're looking at what might actually, how much carbon is actually in 5,000 feet of the Mancos Shale. And I look around and I start running the numbers. You know how much natural gas we produced in this part of the world, in Weld County, Larimer County, in the DJ Basin, in the Wattenberg Field? We've been drilling here for 80 years. Now, this field is primarily an oil field. But in that 80-year period of time, we've produced enough natural gas to run the United States for 4 months. In the Powder River Basin, with these 25,000 natural gas wells, they've produced enough natural gas to run the United States for, you know, 4 or 5 months. And when you go around, there are only about six of these natural gas plays that are of any size that they're dominated by three or four big ones, the Marcellus in Pennsylvania. Maybe it will end up doing 5 years worth of U.S. gas demand over the next 60 or 70 years. The Barnett Shale in Texas is today has not even done 1 year. It's done almost a year worth of U.S. gas demand. So I go 100 years, I go like, dude, you promised me 100 and you shorted me 30, you shorted me 70. You know, when you look around, you can kind of go, peons, we might get 2 or 3 years out of the peons over the next half century. I start trying to add it all up. The math doesn't work for me. So I think the Potential Gas Committee has even begun kind of, John Curtis, who's a very respected geologist there, he's going like, this hype has gotten way out of control. Because if you make energy policy based on the notion you have 100 years worth of natural gas, enough to export, that's kind of where this all rubber hits the road, is when we start telling ourselves a story that we have enough to export natural gas. I'm not convinced we have enough or shouldn't export any natural gas.
I just wonder what the logic is behind the exploration companies' reluctance to publicize, or at least print out for the public to see, the components of the fracturing fluid, and that it would only be released if there was some kind of gross emergency according to Colorado state law, which is the best in the country, backed upon by our governor. And yet, we don't know what's in that stuff, and we wouldn't know about it unless there was emergency, and it would still take 2 weeks to get anyhow. So why all this secrecy about that?
So I think we're getting more visibility into the fracking formulas now than we have. You can imagine when Bill Barrett or Ed Warner or Neil McMurray figured out how to frack these tight sandstones, that working with Halliburton, working with the service companies, there was an aura of, we don't want anyone to know what a slick water formula is, what we're actually putting in to our fracking fluid. I think now it's fairly well understood what the elements of a frack fluid are. What the companies, some of them claim, and it's not so much the oil and gas companies that have this knowledge, some of them claim it's sort of like the formula for Pepsi or Coke, that it's not the individual ingredients, it's how you mix them, right? So that 5 or 6 years ago, that was kind of the claim that I think fundamentally they didn't want us to know that there was diesel fluid in there and acids, really harsh acids. I think those were the things that, you know, from a human health standpoint, that they didn't really want people to understand. There are now websites and clearinghouses. I think we've got a better idea what's in fracking fluid. And there's a lot of, you know, as I mentioned, a lot of toxic stuff underground. In the petrochemicals, I mean themselves. did anybody here work with a guy named Wes Perrin? I would like, Alan knows him. If we could just, we're in a church, so maybe we could do a moment of silence. Wes Perrin died yesterday. He was a friend of mine. He worked with Larry Flowers on the community wind effort and the wind for schools effort out in the Eastern Plain. He was the president of San Miguel Power Corporation, the rural electric utility down in Telluride. He was a huge solar fan. And Wes came to me, 10 or 15 years ago. He said, you know, we read about what you guys have done in your valley. How could we do something similar here in Telluride? And he really galvanized that community, ran for the rural co-op board, won, was elected president, and installed close to 2 megawatts worth of solar down in Telluride. So if just a delightful human being, and in our journey to the sun, we're losing people occasionally that deserve to be remembered, and so if we could just have a moment for Wes, I'd appreciate it. Thank you, Lauren.